Please stand for the reading of God's word. This passage is out of Luke chapter 9, verses 51 through 56. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was heading for Jerusalem. When the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to destroy them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them. Then he and his disciples went to another village. You may be seated.
Thank you. Good morning. It's good to be back. I feel like I haven't seen you guys in a long time. But I'm grateful Chris Blackmore and John Kimmel was preaching. I'm glad John was scheduled to preach last week because I didn't feel sick until about 30 minutes before the service, and I just laid on my couch in my office. So I was actually here hoping no one would walk in. You know, my plan for January had been to start a new tradition of having the first service be our first Sunday be a Sunday on prayer, the second Sunday being one on scripture, MLK weekend being on race, and then right to life the fourth week. But alas, Chris Blackmore didn't get the memo on doing scripture because I didn't tell him and didn't tell anybody, so it's not his fault. But John did prayer last week, and now we find ourselves talking about a super easy topic, race. So let's now pray together and just ask for everyone's blood pressure to drop a little bit here as everyone's wondering what I'm going to say. Father, your church does not have a very good history on this issue. And I just pray now that you might shine light on us. And we are tossed by cultural winds and by winds in the church. And we just want your word to speak to us and help us to follow you. We want to follow Jesus in this way. We pray for those who already have, me too, have things in our mind about this, wondering what's going to be said, defense mechanisms already up. And I just pray you would lower all of them. In Jesus' name, amen. It's a little bit longer introduction than normal as I try to set this up. Why is it so hard to talk about race? Have you tried? Why is there so much suspicion? Why is there so much division, even in the church? There is a broken trust that no single sermon is going to fix. It's hard because race and racism are complex topics. They are painful topics for some people, not everyone, because not everyone lives it. They're lived experiences for some people, like Mihi, but not everyone. It's hard because our church, the church just generally in history, and our own country has been complicit in some pretty terrible things. It's hard because definitions are shifting. I mean, even this past week, the President of the United States called people racist if they did not support his voting rights plan. And people on both sides were like, he may have gone too far. I mean, if you get that from your own party, you know that's probably as strong a rebuke as you're going to get. Or people will attach their economic views to racism. And it's hard because there are Christians who love the Bible and want to follow Jesus that just have different solutions to the issue. They hate racism, but they just think the solutions are different. And so here they are sitting in the same church. And it's hard because we've not all been ethnic minorities in a culture, which really has an impact on how you view things. You haven't lived as a minority where your cultural practices are not accepted. It's hard because we're impatient. We look for simple answers. I think it was H.L. Mencken said that for every complex problem, there is a simple, clear, and wrong answer. We love slogans. It's hard because Satan hates us. If there's any issue that has really messed up the church over 2,000 years, I think racism would probably be on the top of the list. And it's hard because we're all being made in the likeness of Jesus, and we're all at different places. And it's hard because we want to be unified as a church, and we're afraid if I say something, am I going to kind of break our church? And so the kind of modus operandi of most churches is silence. And I have found it personally challenging because it's hard to understand what goes on in your home culture. I don't know, for you who have traveled, you kind of go overseas, and you may even live overseas, and you think you see things so clearly. Like, wow, that is a racist statement. Wow, that is a messed up tribalism. And people are saying things in church like it's just normal. And then you come back to the U.S. and you're like, I don't see anything. It's hard to look in the mirror. It's hard to talk about where you live. We are drawn to strident things. We are drawn to flamethrowers. And there are people within the church and outside the church that are just throwing bombs on this issue, who are not genuinely trying to solve anything, but really just burn the whole place down and call everyone heretics. Now, I'm talking to you as your friend. The Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome. He must be kind. And on MLK weekend, I will talk about this issue every year that I'm here. And today I just want to say, why is it so hard to talk about race? Maybe it's hard because it's a problem. Maybe the fruit of this whole thing is you can't even talk about it without everyone's blood pressure going, what is he going to say? And yet we are a community of redeemed people. We are salt and light, or at least we're supposed to be salt and light. We're supposed to be quick to listen, slow to speak in order to understand what someone else is saying. And here we have in our own country 345 years, 1619 to 1964, where there was violently enforced discrimination. And just because a law is passed 58 years ago doesn't mean that, bang, everything is just solved. Generational impact of sin is a biblical concept. Numbers 14, the Lord is long-suffering. He is great in mercy, forgiving iniquity and transgressions, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquities of the fathers on the third and fourth generation. That is, in a basic framework for the Christian view of a broken world and sin is that it's just not between you and God. Yes, it is between you and God. We set up self-justifying systems. We recommend ourselves to God. And in a sense, one of the ways that we do that is to say we are superior to other people. Look, God, at me. We self-justify ourselves all the time. But it's not just about you and God. Individuals impact individuals. Neighbors impact neighbors. Fathers impact children. And you can't just say, well, it's just my issue. Or you can say, I don't have a racist bone in my body, so I'm just going to, you know, do this. Or I'm not biased at all, so I don't really have to think about this. But let me just say to you gently, you underestimate sin to just do this. You underestimate the love of God to just do this. You underestimate testimony after testimony after testimony of believers telling you it's not what you say. White Caucasians in the U.S. are the least likely group to think there's systemic oppression in the United States. Why? Why just that group? Because they don't experience it. We don't live these issues. And so I have tended to balk myself when an African-American friend of mine turns a messy situation in my mind into a race issue. But here I am, I begin to listen to these people. I have friends who, you know, adopt people from Asian and Africa, and they start experiencing things that they've never experienced before. They're like, why am I hearing things? Why am I hearing taunts? I mean, my friends who experience things with authorities that I've never experienced, why are they keep experiencing those things and keep telling me about them? Then I realize people are saying racist things around me, and I begin to ask myself, why do they feel comfortable saying that around me? What does that say about me? Why am I silent? Because it doesn't impact me? And then you read books like Just Mercy. I remember listening to this book and just throwing stuff in my car, screaming, what is wrong with you people? As injustice upon injustice come down. And then as it gets fixed by the people in power, they self-congratulate themselves after they've stolen 30, 40 years away from people in their life. Look at us, we're so just. A friend of mine even recently wrote me a letter personally just mad at me, honestly. He's just tired of him trying to express what he would see within American evangelicalism, and he would live, and then feeling mocked, dismissed by brothers and sisters in Christ. Like, oh no, that's not real. Cold, distant analysis. And not seeing him as a man, standoffish. And so I begin to ask myself, am I mocking this situation? Do I just think it's ridiculous? Am I running to my favorite political commentator for discipleship and comfort? Am I just afraid people are going to slander me and call me liberal or woke or whatever words? This is a historical problem. This is a global problem. This is a bloody, murderous problem. It is not just an American issue, too. In World War II, the Japanese killed somewhere between 3 and 10 million Koreans, Chinese, Filipinos. Okay, the Jewish Holocaust was 6 million. The Japanese may have killed 10. Ethnic strife. Armenian genocide, 1915, 1 million people. 1994, Rwandan ethnic groups taking machetes to each other. Some of the most racist language I've ever heard was in a Chinese house church. Ask an Indian what they think of Pakistanis. Ask an Ethiopian what they think of Eritreans. Ask an Israeli what they think of Palestinians. And the list just goes on and on and on. Ask an Afghan what they think of Iranians. Or the crazy things I've heard, you know, even in churches in Kenya about, you know, that person's from that tribe. You need to keep things close to you because they might steal it at church. Wait, what? And for us, the treatment of Native Americans, race-based chattel slavery, Jim Crow, hang over our country. And Christian symbols have been baptized to support all of it still today. So I'm not here to preach 10 sermons in one. I'm not here. We don't have that much time. I could keep going, but you guys got to get the donuts, I guess. But Christians have been given categories to think about these issues. We have a story to tell. We are rebels at heart. And it's not too much to think, if we can rebel against God, it's not a big jump to put ourselves over other human beings and to do it naturally. And yet, in the gospel, God is reaching down and redeeming people. So we come to Luke 9, and we come to where Jesus is teaching his disciples something about this issue. I was reading this week of another pastor that said, in the company of Jesus, we are all beginners because we don't know where we are going. And so we follow Jesus now. Let's just see what happens. Luke 9, racial strife in Samaria. You heard the passage read. Sometimes when I read the Bible, do you just skip names? We do that in the genealogy, right? I said that in December. We also do it with cities. We don't know the backstory. So if you're experiencing Luke 9 in person, or you hear about it within, like, you know, a couple years of it happening, you understand Luke 9 is legit a big deal. Jesus resolutely sets himself to Jerusalem. So he's headed to Jerusalem. He's got a mission. His mission is going to the cross. And he is now headed there. And they decide, as a travel plan, let's go through Samaria. Now, a Jew reading this would go, why didn't you go around? People would go around. You don't want to go through Samaria. Samaria are the ethnic mutts. When the northern and southern kingdom divided in the Old Testament, you can read about this a few hundred years before, Samaria became the capital of the northern kingdom. They worshiped at a different site than the Temple Mount. They intermarried. They don't get along with the Jews. The fact that Jesus is even going through there is a big deal. So he sends messengers ahead. We don't know who. The Samaritan village says, where are you going? Oh, we're going to Jerusalem. He can't stay. You know, in John 4, Jesus is talking to a Samaritan woman at a well. And he says, hey, can I have a drink of water? And the Samaritan woman says, why do you, a Jew, why are you asking me, a Samaritan woman, for water? And then the parentheses of John 4. For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. What a wild phrase. Middle of the day, hot, you're thirsty, and you have it in you to think, why would someone ask me for water from that ethnic group? I don't know, because I'm thirsty. Is that hard to imagine? It's not, right? Okay, back to Luke 9. Here comes Jesus, the Jew, into Samaria. He's not welcome. The disciples know that it is an attack on Jesus. And James and John ask Jesus, hey, you told us we've got some power. Can I bring the power down on these people? I mean, you've got power at your disposal from Jesus. Here are these ethnic mutts, these traitors from the north. They've rejected Jesus. And Jesus smothers their wrath. He doesn't even say what he says. He just says he rebukes them. Now, think about this. James and John never react that way when the Jews reject Jesus. They only act that way when the Samaritans don't give him a lodging. Why is it in an identical situation, one group gets the wrath and the other group gets patience? I want you to think about any situation in our culture where that might happen. I've got one. I tried to find one that's not debatable. Okay. You're a black man, you're a white man, you commit the same crime, same background, same history. If you're black, you're getting sentenced to a longer prison sentence every single time, 10 to 20% longer. If you are Hispanic, Latino, or black, you are going to be charged with a harsher crime for the same thing almost every single time because you can't afford a private lawyer. That is an inherent bias in your own culture. There's lots of debatable ones. That one's not debatable. So now we have James and John responding to a slight of Jesus in a different way, same type of thing. Why? Because of ethnic bias. That's it. It's the only thing. Okay. They're angry. Jesus is now headed to Jerusalem. And then Jesus picks up the teaching again in Luke 10. And you may know this parable. You can turn over there. The parable of the Good Samaritan. You've heard this parable. You've heard this story, right? A lawyer comes up to Jesus. The lawyer says, hey, how can I be saved? Love God, love your neighbor. Lawyer says, okay, good. Jesus says, go do that. Lawyer says, I have a question, though. And Luke says, a little parenthesis, seeking to justify himself. Tells you a lot about this lawyer. And who is my neighbor? So the lawyer, the teacher of the law, the expert in the law, depends on what translation you have, is essentially saying, hey, I need some boundaries on who my neighbor is so I can know who to love. And Jesus says, good question. Let me crush you with a parable. And so Jesus now speaks in a parable. Hey, there's a man on the road. He gets robbed. He's on the side of the road. He's left for dead. He's bloody. Here comes a priest. The priest sees him and does this. Other side of the road. Starts walking. Okay, there's the guy. Here comes a Levite. Other side of the road. And then here comes a what? Samaritan. The ethnic mutt. The traitor. And he bandages him, he takes care of him, he puts oil on him, he takes him to an inn, he puts him on his donkey, rides the donkey, does the inn, pays the money, tells the guy, I'm going to come back, and if this guy has, done some surcharges on TV channels or whatever, I'm going to pay for that too. I got this. And the expert of the law says, and Jesus says, who's the neighbor? And the expert of the law, he can't even bring himself to say the Samaritan. He says, the one who had mercy on him. So the Samaritan, the whole story gets flipped. The enemy becomes the savior. The neighbor comes from a place that might surprise you. The religious man walks by the person broken and leaves him for dead. The Levite leaves him for dead. And the person who saves him is the traitor. And so Jesus is teaching. I mean, there's all sorts of lessons here. But just think of this. You have a broken person on the road, and you have a religious person comes and argues this. That's probably his fault. Another person in the church comes and says, you know what? Systemic oppression on this person. It's not his fault. It's just all these things that have happened to him. And then they start arguing in the church against each other. And guess what? That guy's still bloody on the road. And this is where we find ourselves as a church. We arguing about why that's happening. And you look over and you go, well, that guy's still bloody and almost dead. And this is where the debate becomes real. These are people. Those are people. And over here is theoretical. You know, we will prove to be neighbors across difficult and ethnic lines if we're transformed by Jesus. And will we purposely enter in or not? You know, dinner table discussion, that's all theoretical fun stuff, but that doesn't cost you anything. The cost here is pretty significant, and the Levite and the priest don't want to pay it. You know, I think personally that we as Christians overestimate our moral compass. We see ourselves as super moral people, always doing the right thing. We think, you know, this stuff doesn't happen in my church. You know, my friend is a pastor of a prominent evangelical free church. He decided, you know, we're going to just celebrate the diversity within our church. We're going to let the Africans lead worship this Sunday. So they did that. He's walking out afterwards. Longtime member turns and says, I don't ever want to see those monkeys leading worship again on stage. This guy's been sitting under my preaching for 20 years. I guess it's not happening here. It can't be happening here. And if you start saying it can't happen here, it can't happen here, it can't happen here, and then story after story after story, it is happening here. Wow! Robert George, who's a favorite conservative constitutional scholar for many in Princeton, he writes this, sometimes I ask my students what their position on slavery would have been if they were white living in the South before abolition. And guess what? They all would have been abolitionists. And I say, that's nonsense. So I respond by saying, I will credit their claims if they can show me the following things. One, that they are willing to take a view now that is unpopular with their peers, that would cause them to be loathed by the powerful and the elite and influential people. Three, that they would be abandoned by their friends. Four, that they would be called nasty names. And five, that they would risk being denied professional opportunities because of their moral witness. In short, my challenge to them is to show them that they have to risk themselves and their futures in order to make that stance true. We overestimate ourselves. I would never do that. And Jesus leads his disciples in these discussions in surprising ways by smothering their wrath, expanding the boundaries of neighbor, and calling them to costly care. Okay, so let's see what happens now over the next few years. Early church, okay, Jesus dies on the cross. He gets to Jerusalem. He's killed. He's resurrected. Now, we're just staying in Luke Acts. In Acts 1:8, Jesus now gives a commission. What's the commission? You will receive power from the Holy Spirit. Can't wait to preach on that. Has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and guess where? Samaria. Right off the bat, the mission is cross-cultural, it's cross-ethnic boundaries, it's cross-cultural. Hey, you're gonna go to Samaria for the sake of Jesus. Now, I have a friend, he's Korean. He went to Japan as a missionary. His dad converted in Japanese occupation. They gave him a Japanese name. They beat him when he spoke Korean. And he said, you know, all the anger of the Korean people became my anger, and it threatened my ministry to the Japanese people. But eventually he comes to the cross and he says, I knew that I could not claim to hate anyone because of Christ's work. I could not accuse anyone because of Jesus in my life. And what happens? He ends up in Samaria, Japan. Corrie ten Boom ends up sharing the gospel with the Nazis after being in their concentration camp. St. Patrick goes to Ireland. Louis Zamperini ends up in Japan sharing the gospel with his captors. Americans go to Afghanistan. Tribes go to warring tribes. These things happen within the mission. And when the early church goes, Acts 8, it's Philip, Acts 8:5, went to the city of, guess where? Samaria preaching the gospel of Christ. And guess what happens? People start believing. They get baptized. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit's boom, dropping like a bomb. Boom, dropping like a bomb. Free to go wherever he wants. The early church can't control it. And then Acts 9, Saul, you know, converts. He's been killing Christians. And at the end of Acts 9, it says, the church in Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace. What an elusive word that is. The fact that there's even a church in Samaria planted by a Jew is a miracle. But that's not the end. And this is what's so, this gives me somewhat hope. The early church struggled big time on ethnic issues. Peter gets rebuked by the Apostle Paul in Galatians 2, and it's written for all of eternity for people to read. Imagine like some of your worst mistakes. We're going to write them down and people are going to learn from them. For all perpetuity. Galatians 2. You get to Acts 15, 48 AD, 15 to 20 years after the resurrection of Jesus, and they're still trying to figure out, can the Gentiles be Christian or not? 15 years. These are guys who've walked with Jesus for 3 years, seen the Holy Spirit, experienced the power of the Holy Spirit, seen crazy, miraculous things, done them themselves, and they're like, okay, so can this ethnic group really, really be loved by God? Years. To the first followers of Jesus. And there's diversity in the church, celebrated. You don't, what's great, you know, you don't see the early church kind of like saying, we're going to be monocultural. No, it's reconciled. And that's the beauty of the Christian faith. The Christian, Christianity is not like Islam. It is not a culture. Christianity comes to cultures and converts them. So Laman Sané, who's a professor at Yale, he died in the last 2 years. He did a study to show how African Christianity exploded once the Africans realized they didn't need to be European. Like they could be African and be Christian. But it's not like that meeting in Acts 15 fixed everything. The new global family from every ethnic group needed to be reconciled, and the Jew and Gentile thing was not a small thing. In Acts 15. That was not like, why can't you guys figure it out? It was deep. It was hostile. Rome was a colonial occupier of Israel. And then the Romans started coming to Christ and like, how are we supposed to do this? How are the colonial occupiers supposed to worship with us? It was racial. And then Paul, in a lot of his letters, in Ephesians 2 is a great example. What does he tell the church? We were all brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:13. That is, this is not a political issue, first. It's not a social issue. It is a blood of Jesus Christ issue. It is a gospel issue that all the nations are brought near together because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And the early church didn't get it. It took them a while. And if you read the New Testament letters, the early church struggled. Almost every New Testament letter has a racism component in it. And all of them say, hey, the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ. Okay, Samaria, early church, today. This stuff sneaks into our missions. This Middle Easterners who go out and they go to Italy and they go to Spain and comes to the Americas with cultural baggage and the gospel explodes and it goes out. And it gets embedded into our even mission. In 1910, all the missionaries of the world, essentially leaders, got together, and they were figuring, we're going to complete the Great Commission. Jesus is coming back this century because everyone's going to hear the gospel. And one guy, Vendanyam Azariah, I can't even spell his name, but Indian Anglican bishop comes. He's the only non-white guy to speak in the entire mission, global missions conference. And he says this, the relationship between the European missionaries and the Indian workers is not what it should be. A certain aloofness, a mutual understanding of openness and friendship lacks in this country. Through all the ages, we will rise up and bless you. You have given your bodies to be burned. You have fed the poor. Now we are just asking you, give us friends. You think about the juxtaposition of sacrificing for the sake of Jesus, giving your body to be burned, feeding the poor, And the Indian church is saying, will you consider us your equal? Will you be our friends or not? And these issues have been hard in the first century. They're hard between Jew and Gentile. They're hard in global missions, and they're hard in churches. I want to read for you two emails that a pastor received. I think it expresses pretty clearly the divide in a church. Pastor, this was after a tragic shooting of an unarmed black man. Pastor, I write you with sympathy and caution. Sympathy because I know your job is hard. Caution because I can no longer sit under you. Let you know my wife, she's biracial, both white and black, but she is too white for some people and too black for others. And we have found ourselves asking, where is our family, our church? When it comes to racial justice, our brothers and sisters have not shown up for us. The fathers of the church have ignored us. And when she shows up at church, the other women will say, hey, how was your week after a week like this? But someone is more likely to touch her hair than ask her how she's doing. And let me just turn to myself now. You know me, I'm Mexican. And you heard what the President Trump said about my people, and yet you have said nothing except celebrate him. Some days I leave the service feeling like the church is a bunch of racists. So we're leaving the search for a more compassionate church. But white pastor, we need more than prayer from you. But will you at least pray for us? That's a hard email to receive. 5 minutes later, next email. Pastor, while I'm generally grateful for your leadership, I have questions. Why did you lament over that shooting in your prayer? Where's the lament for the abortion or rioting or selective lament? I'm honestly not upset you're lamenting, but I'm not looking for political spins on Sunday. In fact, I don't want politics at all. I can check the news for politics. I just encourage you, just preach the gospel and steer clear of these issues and overemphasizing one sin of the culture that people are fascinated with. Thanks for hearing me out. I look forward to your response. You get both of those emails 5 minutes apart, and you're sitting there and you're like, these are my people. What am I supposed to do? And I'm guessing that as I read those, you're drawn to one over the other. You know, preaching in most conservative churches tends to emphasize personal piety. How do I, not confronting injustice in community. So you kind of shrink the biblical witness of the Bible down to kind of 5 steps to generosity. How can I be a good parent? What is the relationship between me and God? And that's all I really need to talk about. But Paul, you know, and maybe this is a good way to close. Paul, at the end of his ministry, he's writing to Jews and Gentiles who are divided. And he writes at the end of Romans 15:7, accept one another. Accept one another as Christ has accepted you. And this is in a section where there's the strong and the weak. Paul says he's the strong. The strong have it theologically correct, but they have it relationally wrong. You know, one author has pointed out that a secular tolerant person essentially says this: you can believe what you want, but if what I'm doing offends you, it doesn't matter. I'm not changing my belief. And what Paul argues is the opposite, is what I'm doing offending you, I'm willing to change on your behalf. It's the opposite. It's a different kind of attitude than tolerance, this ability to change for the sake of another. And so maybe that's what it should be. Trying dinner table discussions face-to-face instead of social media. Trying to listen to Christians that have different lived experiences. Listening to people who have adopted across cross-cultural lines. And there is a real solution. A solution that affects racial injustice and oppression and exploitation, and it's the cross of Christ. And I have seen it firsthand. I have seen Iranians hug and kiss Jewish believers. You gonna get that anywhere else? I've seen Iranian and Afghans hug each other. I've seen Indian and Pakistani believers. Indian, Pakistan, like if you lose the rugby match, you can't go outside. There, you're gonna get murdered. And I've seen them doing all-night prayer meetings. I've seen Romanian Baptists sob meeting Jewish believers knowing that their parents had murdered their grandparents in the Holocaust. I've seen things that give me hope. So, racial strife in Samaria was real. Jesus confronts their ethnocentrism. It gets into the early church. The early church struggles. They can't even get over it. And there is hope because of the cross of Christ as he draws us near. You know, Mihi said this earlier. In Revelation, at the end, in Revelation 21, in the final state, it says, all the kings of the nations of the earth will bring their splendor. That is, there will be ethnic diversity in heaven that is maintained, and it will be celebrated as God redeems people from every culture and nation. And they will come together bringing their culture with them, and it will be celebrated. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought to the throne. That's Revelation 21. So what are we to do? We should name things in church that are unjust. We should pray. Praying reveals our priorities. We should try to talk to people. One book that's helped me so much is this one, Talking About Race, Gospel Hope for Hard Conversations. You should consider who your neighbor is. Anyone walking across the street on the other side of the road because it costs too much to help? Be slow to speak. I think for the sake of unity, you should recognize that the solutions are varied, even contested among mature believers, and we can talk about them here without fear of being condemned. And then we can celebrate we're in Bozeman, so the little small diversity that we have, we can be excited about it. We're not a monolithic culture or a monolithic church. We have people from different ethnic groups. Thank the Lord in this church because of the blood of Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we just say this is a hard issue. We want to protect the unity of the church, but not have unity for the sake of unity. Help us to think through whether we've been silent when we've heard things people we know say. Help us to think through jokes that we've heard and participated in. Help us to think through being in a culture that does have bias. Help us to think through institutional sin. Lord, you judge the nations, you judge the generations, and you judge individuals. And we just ask that you would have mercy on us. Lord, we are all brought near because of the blood of Christ as we are trying faithfully to walk with you.